What's up, RIZN? What's up? What's up? Hey, real quick. Man, there's a lot of you guys. Hey, do you guys like choose your own adventure stories? Have you guys read them before? I love choose your own adventure stories. So tonight, what I actually did was I wrote 6 different messages, and I want you guys to choose which one before I begin. And so here's how this is going to work. When I say go, you guys have to find, there's under 6 chairs in the room, there's a piece of paper, and yeah, let's look right now. First one, bring it to me in my hands. I'm gonna do that message in my hands. Oh, sorry, he beat you. Man, that was fast. Okay, number 6. You guys chose, thanks boys, good job. He won, it was a race. That went way faster than I thought. Okay, boys in the back, we're doing message number 6. And if you guys want, I have the other 5 messages written, so maybe I'll preach them over the next like 5 months or something. We'll find out. Message number 6. The kind of bad part about message number 6 is that I have different stories at the start of each message. And this story I've only told 3 people. And it's pretty embarrassing. And I'm kind of scared, I'm not going to lie. I kind of feel like I need to pee myself thinking about this story. But hey, real quick though, whose first time is it here tonight? Anybody? What's up, guys? Well, hey, give it up for the first timers. Hey, if you didn't know, for the next about 20 minutes, if it's your first time, we're just going to hang out. I'm going to share a couple stories with you guys, and we're going to talk about Jesus a little bit. But before that, I got this story for you guys. So when I was 16, I got my driver's license. I was in grade 10, and it was the end of grade 10. So it was kind of like May, June. I officially got it in May, but then in June, my parents went away for almost a month to Italy. And you can tell my dad and me are alike because we're both not good at making decisions, and my dad decided to leave his car keys with me while he was away. Beautiful dad, I love you, thank you so much. And so he leaves his car keys with me, and it's exam season, it's June, you know how it is. I'm like pretty stressed with exams, grade 10. I was trying to be an overachiever, but really wasn't good at school. And so I'm at school, and I leave school, and I go home, and I decide that night I'm going to go hang out with some friends. Actually, they were my RIZN leaders at the time. I'm going to go to their house and just hang out with them and rip some Minecraft. I don't know, what do people do? We ate pizza. It was fun. So we're hanging out at their house, and then urgently I remembered that I had an exam the next day. I don't know how I forgot it. So I literally, like, look at my time. It's like 8:30. I was supposed to leave at 8. So I stand up as quick as I can. You guys know how this feels. I stand up, and I'm like, I got to go. So I literally run to the door. I don't even know if I said bye, but I was tying my shoes. And as I'm tying my shoes, I remember just feeling like, this is so embarrassing. I remember just thinking like, man, I kind of got to pee. And so I'm like, okay, I gotta pee, but I also gotta go study, so I'm a man, it's all good, I'm gonna get home, and David Goggins would do this, he would get home and pee at home, so this is what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna go home, and I'm gonna pee when I get there, and so I get in my car, and I never took biology, but I'm pretty sure that when you have a feeling of needing to pee, it like multiplies when you sit down. Anybody experience that? So I am, if you feel like that right now, just head to the back. But I sit in my dad's car about a week into driving. Don't know why I have his car. And he gives this feeling of pee just like multiplies. And so at the time I was broke, so I didn't have anywhere to, I couldn't check my phone. I didn't have data, so I couldn't look at somewhere to stop to pee. But I'm like, okay, I got to stop no matter what. So I'm driving around a neighborhood I've never been in, and I got to pee. I end up stopping at a No Frills, and guaranteed your grandma was in that parking lot because everybody's grandma was in that parking lot because everybody was driving so slow. And I finally get a parking spot, and I whip my door open, and I stick my leg out the door, and it's like Niagara Falls, bro. I didn't even stand up. The floodgates let loose, and I absolutely pee myself in my dad's nice car that he trusted me with. And you guys are the only people who know that story other than 3 others. And my parents don't know that story, so don't tell my dad, because they came home 3 weeks later. I remember just being so embarrassed. I went home, and I, like, my brother was there, and I was just like, shut up. don't talk to me. I was so mad. Took my jeans, threw them in the garbage, had to steam clean the car. Actually, this is gross, but I didn't steam clean the car for a few days. So I just like sat a towel on the chair, went to school the next day, and just sat on this damp pee chair driving to school for about a week. And then I steam cleaned it, and then my dad's car, my dad was like, man, the car is so clean. Good job, man. Hey, who in the room was at, I didn't practice number 6 that much, so we'll see what happens with this message, but who in the room was at RIZN camp this year? Wow, like almost everybody. Hey, if you weren't at RIZN camp, don't worry, you'll be there next year. But RIZN camp, crazy fact, the first day of RIZN camp was exactly 25 days ago. So Monday of RIZN camp was almost a month ago, 25 days ago. And I've been to camp quite a bit over the years, and I find that I kind of get into this cycle every year of RIZN camp, where like 1 to 2 months leading up to RIZN camp, I'm like getting pumped. I got like adrenaline in my veins. I'm like getting hype. I'm like, what dorm are you in? We're in the same dorm. What team are you on? You're on yellow. You're on blue. You're a bloozer. Like you're going down. Wow. Come on now. Who won this year? Red. Nice. Nice. But yeah, I have this anticipation building up to camp, and it's for a good reason. Because if you're at RIZN camp or you've ever been, you know how good RIZN camp is. And God just, on top of all the incredible food and these games and whatever we're doing, and you get to stay in a dorm with your 5 best friends and blah, 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 blah. On top of all that, God works these crazy miracles. And you watch people get healed, and you watch lives get changed forever. And we commit our whole lives to Jesus, and it's like, wow, this is so good. It's like RIZN camp. It's like so fun. But sometimes I would leave camp and be like, why can't I have this feeling all the time? This like spiritual high, this like adrenaline in my spirit, just like, ah, like just so good. Why can't I have that when I go back home? Because normally I would go back home and I'd probably nap for like 14 hours. You know how it is. Like you just sleep from Friday to Saturday and then wake up for an hour and then sleep from Saturday to Sunday. And then on Sunday after RIZN camp, all your best friends get baptized, which is incredible. And then life kind of just goes back to normal. And you're kind of just like, dang it. Like, can I go back? I miss camp. And quite frankly, at least for me, I find that I kind of just like fall into this like spiritual like lukewarmness, to be honest. And the truth is, if camp is the best week of the year, then logically the other 51 weeks of the year are less than camp. And I think that is true in some aspects. I'm not ripping Mission Impossible with my friends in like a random week of the year. But I don't think this has to be true for your relationship with Jesus. I don't think this has to be true for the spiritual area of your life. Who says we can't experience God in a deeper way every week of the year, every day of the entire year? And don't get me wrong, it is gonna be multiplied at RIZN camp, but I don't think it needs to be divided that much every other week of the year. That's kind of what I want to chat with you guys about, though, because I think this really is the start of something new. I actually believe that this next season of your life could quite literally be a catalyst for the rest of your life. Whether you've recently given your life to Jesus, you gave your life to Jesus a long time ago, or maybe you're here tonight and you don't even know who Jesus is. You've never heard of him. You've never thought about giving your life to him. I think that if you're open to it and you're hungry for more, that this season will be the start of something new. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this opportunity just to be with you tonight. Holy Spirit, thank you that you're here right now, God. Would you just use me as a branch of your vine, God? Use me as a vessel. Holy Spirit, just speak through me right now. Thank you for each and every one of these kids, God. I pray their hearts would just be open to receive this message from you. In your name we pray, amen. So in my search for how to break this cycle, I decided to obviously look at kind of what the Bible has to say about it. And if you've given your life to Jesus, you're kind of in this season now called sanctification. Sanctification is a huge word. Say it, sanctification. Good. I couldn't pronounce it for a long time. But sanctification is this season of your life that, well, I shouldn't actually call it a season because it's actually going to be the rest of your life. But the crazy thing about it is you actually decide the rate at which it takes place. But ChatGPT told me that sanctification is the process of thinking like, acting like, and becoming more like Jesus. And that's what the rest of our lives are all about. But like I said, we kind of get to decide the rate at which this takes place. Because in theory, every single one of us in the room want to experience Jesus like we did at camp, or just in a deeper way all the time. We want to experience him in our day-to-day. But whether we get to or not, somewhat is kind of up to us. Because whether you have a deep devotion to Jesus or you barely scratch the surface is up to you. I feel like all I do is preach these two scriptures, but James 4:8 says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. So who draws first? We do. It's a simple formula. If we want to be close to God, we have to draw near to him first. Step one is us. Step two is him. And I think the cool thing, Sophie shared this earlier with some of our leaders, but God is like waiting for you. His posture is literally like he's leaning in, like waiting for you. And the question isn't if he's there for you. The question is if you're going to come to him. And if you're wondering why you aren't close to God, I would ask you, when was the last time you put any effort into getting close to him? Maybe the last time was RIZN camp, but I think that can change today. What else did Jesus say about this? In Matthew 6:33, straight, he said, but seek first his kingdom. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. Seek first his righteousness and seek first his kingdom. Seek first God. Seek him first. And then all these other things will be added to you as well. But what do? We have to seek him first. So what do? We seek first the one who matters most. We seek first his kingdom. Or in other words, we are devoted to Jesus. I am devoted to Jesus. Say that. I am devoted to Jesus. Well, what does it mean to be devoted to Jesus? Again, greatest dictionary of all time, ChatGPT, told me that being devoted to something or someone is to have a strong, unwavering commitment, loyalty, and dedication to them. And this can be measured in what we call small devotions. And for example, if you're dating somebody, anybody in the room dating? Only a couple? That means there's lots of options for you who are not. But when you're dating somebody, it's usually measured by, whether you realize it or not, small devotions. For example, small gifts that you're going to give them over time and quality time that you spend together and just, you know, little hugs and whatever you do in relationships and just quality time spent together and just other things that represent your deep, selfless love for them. Little devotions, they add up over time. And if you're devoted to, I don't know, like a cause or a job or really anything else in your life, we can all agree that you typically devote time to it, right? And you'd probably actually prioritize it to some degree. And honestly, sometimes you'd probably even sacrifice for it. So if we're devoted to Jesus, are we doing any of those things as well? I remember feeling convicted. I think this happened when I was like 15 or 16, but I was in a service where we sang a song. I'm actually pretty sure it was Build My Life. And I felt convicted because I could sing these lyrics that I will build my life upon your love. But I never actually did. I just sang the song over and over again, but didn't really have the application to actually do it. Next week, I'm excited because my boy Malachi is actually going to show us what doing devotions means and what it means when Christians say they're doing devotions and how to actually read and digest the Bible, like actually do it. But I think so often we say God is our Savior, but neglect to actually make him our Lord. And there's a big difference. So what does it mean to be devoted to Jesus? Hey, let's pause here for a minute. I remember this illustration from a long time ago, but I want to share it with you guys. There is 168 little boxes on the screen. And if you, it's not 169, Ephraim, you said that, bro. But it wasn't Ephraim. But It's 168 little boxes. Maybe I said that. This represents how many hours you have. I think I have ADHD. I don't know. This represents how many hours you have in a week, in the average week. 168 hours in your week. And everybody has the same amount of hours, right? Pretty straightforward. So if you're devoted to something, I think we can all agree that you would typically devote some time to that thing, right? Like if you wanted to get good at basketball, you would have to devote time to basketball. Pretty straightforward, right? Easy equation. But my question is, where do you typically spend your time in an average week? Now, on average, the normal person spends about 56 hours or one-third of their time sleeping. Now, obviously, you guys might not sleep 8 hours every night, but typically, if you're not, it's because you, procrastinated your homework, so you're getting less sleep, or, you're ripping Netflix late at night or whatever, but then you probably sleep in on Saturday and Sunday, and so it's about a third of your week, give or take, is sleeping. Now, the average, I would say, do you guys go to school for how long, like 6 hours a day-ish? Wow, okay, we'll call it six. And then let's say you go to school for 6 hours a day, and then you have about a one-hour commute, maybe half an hour there, half an hour back, whatever. Let's say that's on average. About 35 little boxes or little hours are dedicated to school. And then after that, you have about 77 hours left in your week. Not that much, but who in the room has social media? I do. We all do. And the average social media user spends, believe it or not, most studies show about 17 hours a week, but the average teenager spends about 22 hours a week. So we're gonna say 22 hours dedicated to social media. What about other screen time? Netflix, Disney Plus, Prime Video, I don't know, what do you watch? YouTube Premium, if you're like weird, like a nerd or something. Then like let's say you're spending some time on that. The average Netflix user costs the whole year ends up devoting about an hour a day to Netflix. Now, obviously, you're probably not watching Netflix every single day, but then on Saturday, you could be watching 6 hours. So it equals about an hour a day, give or take, or whatever streaming service, YouTube Premium, you guys use. So let's actually just take that. We'll round it to 30 hours a week, and we'll call it screen time. 30 hours a week of screen time. If you think that's crazy, look at the screen time on your phone. And if it's in the range of 4 hours a day, which is pretty normal, actually it's a little bit below average, most studies show, then you fall into this category. And you might make an excuse like, but I use my phone for my Google Maps and my messages and notes. That doesn't count as entertainment, so I'm not all green like that. But if you then, at the time that you spend on your TV, your Nintendo Switch, your laptop, and your iPad, yeah, I'm probably being generous. It's probably actually more than that. So this leaves us 47 precious hours, precious white little boxes in our week. Now, believe it or not, there's this other category called, I just want to call it other stuff. This is like basically going to fill in the rest of your week. Other stuff. Now, this is your part-time job, if you're, you have one. Or I don't know, what do you got? You're going to the bathroom, you gotta eat, you gotta do chores, you gotta FaceTime your boyfriend and your girlfriend and riz up this other person, and you're FaceTiming this guy, and you gotta hang out with this person, and you're going to, I don't know, man, ripping McDonald's, but it's not good anymore, so you're going to what's better than McDonald's? Nothing much. And then you're doing chores, you're hanging out with your mom. Every time you hang out with your mom, it takes double the amount of time you thought it was gonna take. And then like it's just other stuff. Walking your dog, walking your armadillo, what do you do in your life? I don't know. Like just your other stuff. It just takes up almost all of your week. And then kind of get to the end, and you're like, oh yeah, I'm a Christian. Oh my gosh, I forgot I'm devoted to Jesus. I forgot that, right? So, dang it, I'm so busy with everything else. So, I got 1 hour left though, and God, it's all yours. I'm devoted to you. I'm a Christian, and I'm devoted to you. So devoted, as you can see. And then, I found I got stuck in this cycle for so long. Because typically, this might look like just sitting through a 1 hour service on a Friday night. and calling it devoted to Jesus. Or if you're a really good Christian, it could look like two boxes and you're sitting through a Friday service and a Sunday service. Wow. But don't get me wrong. I think a lot of us in the room are way more devoted to Jesus than 1 hour a week. But I also think some of us aren't even that. And the truth is, if you only devote 1 hour a week to anything, you probably won't see much change take place. Try being devoted to the gym 1 hour a week and then eating whatever you want. You're not devoted. You're going to be fat. Try, that was a little savage. I'm sorry. That was my personal. Try devoting an hour a week to your girlfriend or boyfriend. You'll probably be single by the end of the week. It's true, if you really think about it. So if we are only partially devoted to God in this little one little box, that's all he gets. He gets my best, this one little box. It's no wonder we fall back into the same old sin and wonder why. It's no wonder we sit here and we just wonder, God, where are you? Why can't I have that same experience I did at camp all the time? It's no wonder we barely share our faith. We barely even remember that we are a Christian. It's no wonder we worry about what people think more than about what God thinks. It's no wonder we find ourselves lukewarm, wondering if there's anything more to life. And we just get stuck in this annual cycle of devoting 1 week to God and 51 weeks not. Or at least I did. So we have to ask ourselves, are we really devoted to Him? We need to be devoted to Jesus. Say, I am devoted to Jesus. That's so good. Me too. So how do we... I feel like I explained the problem pretty good, but the good news is there's a solution. And I've been listening to this leadership guy, podcast, whatever, reading books. What do people do? Mostly podcasts for me. I don't really read that well. And he often talks about this habit of pre-deciding. And this is my life. What is pre-deciding? It's exactly what it sounds like. It's to decide before what you will do later. And one of the best ways to ensure you're living a God-honoring, forward-thinking, people-loving life is to decide before how you're going to act or react later. And instead of letting those 168 hours control you, you need to pre-decide that you're going to control those hours. We have to pre-decide three things. This is like the best thing has changed my life. I remember, I don't have time to tell you. But you have to pre-decide three things: your time, a place, and a plan that you're going to spend with Jesus. Time is pretty straightforward. Maybe for you, it's right when you wake up in the morning. Maybe it's before school, after you rip breakfast. Maybe it's, oh man, who knows? It could be after school, before dinner, after dinner, before you go to bed. It could literally be in your bed before you're going to sleep. For me, for years, it was actually just the time I spent on the bus ride to and from school I just dedicated to God. It could be whatever it is for you. Sometimes in the busiest seasons of my life, I remember I actually just devoted, this is so like embarrassing, but whatever time I had in the bathroom, I would just devote to Jesus. And I would purposefully just like skip class and spend as much time as I could in there. And I was literally on the throne, thinking about the one who's on the throne. It was goated. But it could be whatever it is for you, right? It's gonna be different depending on your life. But there is time. There is time. What could you say no to in order to say yes to Him? And you need a place. This one's easy. For me, it's in my basement. I have a little office, and I spend time there at least once a day. But it could be literally anywhere. Your front porch, your back porch, this bench in the nice dog park, this whatever, your kitchen table, your bed before you go to bed. It could be literally anywhere. And then you need a plan. Like I said, we're going to dig into next week what exactly it's like to read and digest the Bible and give you guys a good kind of like application on how the heck do you do this. But I find it's easy to, when I'm kind of confused, I'll do one of two things. I'll go on the Bible app, which if you don't have it, I encourage you to download it tonight and add me. You can add friends. And then I'll just whatever I'm feeling like, anxious, overwhelmed, happy, blah, 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 I'll just find a Bible plan that corresponds to that. And they're anywhere from like 3 days to like however long you want. But imagine if you spent the next 3 days, 5 minutes a day with Jesus and just built that up over time. Sometimes I don't like the strict Bible plans, so I'll just commit to, for example, I'll if I'm reading through the book of Proverbs, 31 Proverbs, I could read one a day for the next month. Easy peasy. Any one of us could do that, right? Whatever the plan is, you just have to commit to one. I can promise you two things. Consistent devotion to Jesus will draw you closer to him. If you actually draw near to him and maybe devote a couple more boxes to him, he will draw near to you. He's literally waiting, arms open, leaning towards you, waiting for you to lean into him. And I promise you one more thing, that there will be resistance. Anything hard that you have to do will have resistance. Stuff will come up in your life. You'll have whatever, basketball practice, you gotta walk your armadillo, whatever happens, stuff comes up in your life. But your human nature will be to make excuses. I wanna encourage you that if it's important, you'll find a way. And if not, you'll find an excuse. And real quick, I think practically the best way to kind of like up your time with Jesus would be to start coming to church on Sunday. Church has literally changed my life. I could go on forever, but this Sunday, we're actually gonna be talking about this kind of topic a little bit more and be talking about the presence of Jesus and how do we have it in our everyday life and just the truth that nothing will satisfy you like the presence of God will. And so I personally want to invite you to church this Sunday. All the youth, we all sit in the front on the left. And I want you guys to sit with me up there and just be open to what God wants to do. And just dedicate one more box to him this Sunday. Services, 9:30, 11. See you there. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for, God, just this opportunity to be in your house tonight, God. And just God, the promise that when we draw near to you, when we seek your kingdom first, when we seek first the one who matters most, God, that you are there just open and waiting and ready for us, God. And God, we just dedicate this next season, God, that it is the start of something new, Lord. We're so excited to just get to know you more. And hey, if you're here tonight and you've never heard about this whole Jesus thing, or you feel like it might be your time to make a decision to actually follow him, to be devoted to Jesus, for real, I want to give just a moment to do that right now, and it's super easy, but we're all just going to pray a prayer together, and it's as easy as that. And then you enter into this season of sanctification, like I explained, for the rest of your life, of just drawing near to him and just watching him show up in your life. And so if that's you today, with everybody's eyes closed, head bow, all that good stuff, would you just like let me know somehow? Just give me a wave, give me a thumbs up, let me know. So awesome. That's awesome. Congrats. You guys can put your hands down. Let's pray. Would you guys repeat after me? God, thank you so much for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross and pay for my sins. Today I declare that you are Lord of my life, and I am devoted to you. Amen. Hey, right now,